Remember the last episode where I praised Bach as the father of Western music and the most important composer of all time? If you don't, that means you haven't seen my video about Baroque music. Go watch it, because it's a really cool video. If you do remember and you're expecting me to talk about the greatness and masterpieces of Johann Sebastian Bach, then let's forget all of that for now. Reason 1, people in this time period didn't care much about Bach. Reason 2, the episodes about Bach are still in the making. So please bear with me. Now, without further ado. First, let's see what do I mean by real classical music. When you hear the term classical music, you might think of music by Bach, Chopin, or all you can think about is Debussy. Well, what if I told you, none of these people are classical musicians? Not saying you are wrong though, they are classical musicians, but not classical musicians. Yeah, let me explain. The term classical music is a broad term including about 1,500 years of Western European music, meaning from medieval Gregorian chant to modern composers adding screws in their piano and electricity in their music. All these are considered classical music. However, within the 15 centuries of classical music period, there is one time period that is literally called classical period. Just for the musicologists to confuse the heck out of you. So what exactly happened in this time period? And what are the changes of musical style from the previous Baroque period? The classical period started in the year 1750. Around this time, after centuries of absolute monarchy and the Catholic Church doing whatever the hell they want, the Enlightenment movement became popular, where the authority of monarchy and the church were being questioned by great philosophers. In the mid-18th century, the rulers of Prussia and Austria, although being absolute monarchs, were kind of into the idea of the Enlightenment. As the result, the nobility in these German-speaking regions became less power-hungry and more passionate in art and music. And therefore, Prussia and Austria, especially Vienna, became perfect places for musicians to make a living under the patronage of the nobility. The downside of this patronage system, however, is that these musicians usually had limited freedom of creation and had to do whatever their patrons wanted. Meanwhile, the style of music had also changed since the Baroque period. If you have watched my previous video about Baroque music, which you should, you might remember that multi-voiced, complicated, jazz-singing, polyphonic music. While in classical period, they got something different called style galant. While polyphonic composers like Bach would be like, here's a melody, and here's a repeat of the same melody, and here's yet another repeat of the same melody.
Lots and lots of episodes.
That means melody over the same melody over the same melody.
Here comes the same melody again.
It's like,
that's what just
subscribe to how classic
of the melody, repeat of the melody, and repeat of the melody.
Style galants would be like, here's the main melody, and here's the accompaniment. End of story. And this is the reason why Bach's music were considered outdated in classical period. This pretty much sums up the typical style of classical period. Clear main melody and accompaniment, simple, light, and boring? No, not boring, wake up! Because while the style of music was getting simpler, the instrumentation and musical forms were developing. Remember these musical terms that had no specific meaning during the Baroque period? Well, in classical period, musicians finally gave these musical terms some clear definitions, making them some of the most iconic forms of music ever since. Classical period musicians became fond of the idea of four-movement music, meaning it sounds like four separated pieces, but are in fact one big musical piece. And when a four-movement piece of music is performed with a solo instrument, it is defined as a sonata. Here's a brief demonstration of how a sonata typically works. The first movement is fast and in the form of sonata form, which contains three parts: exposition, development, and recapitulation. The exposition has two themes. The first theme is sort of like the main character.
It's me!
And the second theme is like the side character, but is in different key with the first theme.
Mamma mia!
And it's where things begin to develop. The development is where things go wild, and constantly changes keys and harmonies. After this crazy part of development, the recapitulation is pretty much the return of the exposition, repeating the two themes. But this time, the second theme is in the same key with the first theme, and is where the movement comes to an end. Now I know the first movement is quite complicated, but here's the second movement. The second movement is slow. Yeah, that's pretty much it. Just slow. The third movement is fast and lighthearted, either dance music or a humorous piece. But this movement is usually pretty short, and is sometimes even omitted. The fourth movement is fast and in the form of rondo form, where the main themes repeat several times, with about two or three different themes between them. While the idea of this fourth movement sonata is structured for solo instruments, the regulation of instrumentation were also being standardized, and the idea of fourth movement sonata is also used for other instrumentations. For example, chamber music is sonata, but with many instruments. Symphony is sonata, but with many, many, many instruments, or the now standardized orchestra. Concerto is sonata, but with many, many instruments, all accompanying one solo instrument. Oh, by the way, wonder what this cool-looking keyboard instrument is? This is a forte piano, the main type of keyboard instrument in classical period, replacing the previous harpsichord. Unlike string-plucking harpsichord, forte piano makes sounds by hitting the strings with hammers when keys pressed. So it's pretty much the beta version of the piano. So the new musical forms were being established and developed during the classical period, under the help of great musicians such as two of Bach's sons, C.P.E. Bach and J.C. Bach, as well as Christoph Willibald Gluck, who was a great reformer of opera. And then there's someone whose contributions can't be hidden, Franz Joseph Haydn. Throughout his life, while all these new musical forms were flourishing, Haydn was like, "Hey, I found this new form of symphony. Wonder what if I wrote over 100 of it?" And then earned himself the name Father of Symphony. "Hey, I found these new instrumentations of chamber music. Wonder what if I wrote over 100 of them?" And then earned himself the name Father of String Quartet. "Hey, I found this new pair of scissors. Wonder what if I cut my classmate's hair with them?" And then earned himself the dumbest way to get kicked out of the church choir. Although Haydn didn't necessarily invent his symphony nor string quartet, he did play a key role in the development of them. But Haydn wasn't all about those serious form developing stuffs. He also had a good sense of humor, which can be seen in his music. For example, he once wrote a symphony with a slow movement starting off with a light, soft, and calm melody, which you can relax or even fall asleep to. Then all of a sudden, BANG! Scaring the crap out of everyone in the audience. This symphony would later be known as the Surprise Symphony. And then there's once that Haydn, in protest against his patron forcing his musicians to overwork, wrote a symphony where the performers begin leaving in turn in the final movement, leaving only two violinists at the end. This symphony would later be known as the Farewell Symphony. Besides symphonies, Haydn also composed many other masterpieces like sonatas, operas, oratorios, and even the national anthem of Germany, managing to be the most popular composer in classical period, just for a 5-year-old to kick his butt. That's right, I'm talking about Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, best known as a child prodigy. His father was a music teacher and was giving music lessons to Mozart's elder sister. But then little Mozart just stole a show with his incredible talents of music. Around the age of 5, Mozart already began composing short pieces. At the age of 8, he composed his first symphony, and at the age of 11, his first opera. His father noticed the unusual talents of Mozart and decided to give up his own composing career and focus on training the young Mozart. And maybe in the meantime make some profit out of it. When Mozart was 6, his family went on tour through Europe to show off their children's musical talents. During this time, Mozart did a lot of successful performances, met a lot of cool people, and also got a deadly disease and almost died. Mozart then went back to his birthplace, Salzburg, for almost a decade, but then was like, "You know what? Screw this patronage system!
I'm Mozart, for crying out loud. I can compose whatever I want without people telling me what to do, and people will love me and give me financial support. And so he went to Vienna to become possibly the first freelance musician ever. At first, it went pretty well, but then it didn't. In 1791, Mozart became very productive, but also got some serious health issues which worsened day by day. It doesn't help that some mysterious guy in black came out of nowhere to Mozart and said,
"Hey, you wanna write some funeral music?"
Mozart was like, "Okay." And then he wrote a few parts of his famous Requiem, but died before he could finish it. With his body now buried in some unknown place, meaning anyone in Austria has the risk of accidentally stepping on Mozart's body and getting haunted by a ghost of Mozart forever. But Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, he's definitely one of the composers that I'll make videos about. Reason 1, despite his short life of 35 years, Mozart composed hundreds of musical works, mastered almost every genre in his time, making his works the most representative of the typical style of classical period. Reason 2, he's one of the most famous composers and can get me more views. Musicologists usually consider 1820 as the last year of classical period, which is a little bit awkward for some musicians who are stuck between the late classical period and the next romantic period. But to refrain from me procrastinate any further and not be able to talk about these composers again in forever, let's now consider them to be classical period composers and briefly talk about them. Niccolo Paganini, possibly the most iconic violin master of all time. He allegedly sold his soul to the devil for his outstanding violin skill that not only amazed his audience, but also makes him one of the most important pioneers of modern violin technique. His most famous works include his 24 caprices and 6 violin concertos. Gioacchino Rossini, a composer who wrote 39 operas that made him one of the most popular composers of his time. But then merely at the age of 37, he suddenly stopped composing opera and instead spent more time on having some fine dining for the rest of his life. Where's the lamb sauce? He still composed other types of music, but not many. His most famous works include The Barber of Seville and William Tell. Franz Schubert, born in an unwealthy family, but like Mozart, Schubert has shown his musical talents since early age, which made him a prolific composer. However, his works were not admired by general public during his lifetime, except for a circle of friends he had. It was until 1828, when Schubert performed a very successful concert, which finally earned him some appreciation, just for him to get overshadowed by Paganini and then died only a few months later at the age of 31. Despite his short life, Schubert has composed over 1500 works, including many genres, but most famously, his 600 Lieder. Lied, or in English, art song, is a vocal song using poem as lyrics, usually accompanied by piano. Schubert is the most iconic composer of Lieder with his ability of storytelling, from a fish swimming in the brook, to a child murdering monster in the forest. Schubert depicted them perfectly. So now you might be asking, but how did classical period end? What started the next romantic period? What caused such a big change? Well, I got 3 words for you. Ludwig von Beethoven. Another great composer that I definitely will make videos about. Reason 1, he's one of the most famous composers and can get me more views. But reason 2, he's perhaps the most influential composer of all time that made a huge change in music history. Beethoven was born in the time when Mozart was a superstar. To make Beethoven the next Mozart, his father decided to be like Mozart's father and began teaching Beethoven music when he was little. And by doing that, he heavy drank, woke Beethoven up at midnight to play the piano. And slapped him in the head for any single wrong note. When Beethoven grew up, he wanted to go to Vienna with Mozart as his teacher. But instead, Haydn became his teacher, and they didn't necessarily like each other. Nevertheless, Beethoven's early works were strongly influenced by traditional classical style like Mozart and Haydn. Possibly because of his abusive father, Beethoven was very short-tempered. Throughout his life, he broke many pianos, broke his own hearing, but most importantly, he began breaking away from classical styles when he became increasingly deaf. This period of time when he was kinda deaf but not completely deaf is usually considered his middle period. During this period, many innovative works were written, such as his Third Symphony, which is a remarkable work transitioning from classical period to the next romantic period. His famous Fifth Symphony, Sixth Symphony, and many other masterpieces such as his only opera, Fidelio. Some concertos and some great piano sonatas were also composed during his middle period. When Beethoven became nearly completely deaf, he still did not give up his composing career. Instead, he became even more innovative in his late period. Most famously, his Ninth Symphony would become one of the most greatest masterpieces in human history. Beethoven is widely considered the great composer who started the Romantic period with his revolutionary musical ideas. Almost every musician after Beethoven sees him as a musical god, even until today.